If you don't read the newspaper, you're uninformed. If you do read it, you're misinformed. What is the long-term effect of too much information?
Information, information. I just need some information. I've been dying, I've been dying. Is it lack of education? I've been reading without any transformation. I'm addicted, is it overstimulation? Hey.
Welcome to the Success Report.
The Success Report.
Hear ye, hear ye. Come one, come all. You are listening to the Sixth Sense Report with Joel Nikoloff and Darnell Samuels.
Welcome to the Sixth Sense Report.
How you doing, Joel?
I'm doing well, man.
Good, good, good.
You ready to jump into this one?
Yeah, man. The We Rise Together, the Peel District School Board Action Plan to Support Black Male Students.
Mm-hmm. And Peel District is essentially just three cities.
Yeah, and yeah. Well, we're from, but I'm sure
Brampton and Mississauga and Caledon.
Yeah, but this is still a popular narrative, a common narrative, a common issue mm-hmm. when it comes to you know, the black community and black males, particularly in the school system, and them not doing well. So our region, our district school board, has taken the initiative to help these young men do better. And so as, you know, September comes upon us and school is around the corner, why not do like a little back to school episode?
Yeah. And, you know, there's a bit of controversy around this. I mean, not a lot, but there's a few articles, a few, you know, especially there's some stuff dated 2019. I mean, this study or this documentation comes out of like...
This report
comes out of 2015, 2016, 2017 time frame is when, you know, the origins and studying was going on.
Mm-hmm.
So it was in 2015 to 2016 school year, they held focus groups. I think I saw some articles around the end, you know, end of 2016, 2017 school year. At the end of that was when they started, you know, probably started trying to roll out programs, or let's say the conclusions of this study. And then now... you know, there's some complaints that maybe that not enough is being done, or that you know, that they want more action, let's say. But that said, I think evaluating a program like this is something we're good at / we like to do. The reason I say we're good at, I think for me, just looking at the statistical side of it and going, mm-hmm. you know, are we drawing conclusions properly?
Yeah. And it's funny because I was looking at the statistics because, again, I'm not a numbers guy. So I'm very interested to hear your perspective on the numbers as a numbers guy. Mm-hmm. So what was the first thing that stuck out to you?
You know, my first instinct is... What, like, I'm a little disappointed in the idea, like, the lack of comparing students that are in the same level of success. So what I mean by that is, like, so even if we concluded that black male students have a higher rate of unsuccess or failure within the school system, are there commonalities with them, with the other kids, right? So if you, let's use some simple numbers just for argument's sake. If, you know, 10% of the kids are just completely unsuccessful and need help within the school system. And we found that, like, of that 10%, 7% are black kids.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what about the 3%? Like, we've just excluded the 3%. With this program, where it probably would, my question is that 3% show commonality with the 7% that this might be addressing? Now, I don't think the numbers are, you know, 70% black and 30% other within that 10% failing mark. Like, I'm just mm-hmm. creating numbers for argument's sake. But the point being, you know, are there commonalities that aren't exclusive to the black male student
experience,
right? That we.
So you're saying, like, if are there brown kids?
And
they're white kids
that
are in the failing that all have the same characteristics as contributing factors. Mm. Because now you've just created a program that excludes them from the help that actually that, applies to all of them.
Mm, interesting. I never thought about that.
Right? So again, you know, this is again, I'm not saying there aren't things that are going to be exclusive to Black students that may, and Black male students that we need to address. I'm just saying that I'm disappointed, you know, and it'll come out more as we hash through some of the stuff. And again, it's more of the statistical side of me. It's this idea of a control group or control groups where, like, you're taking, you know, in a sense, the Black male student and comparing them with, let's call it, everybody else, or compare it with the control group being, we're not going to look at race, right? So the control group in this case, what I was referring to would be, take all of the students who are failing and, you know, exclude this, the Black students. What do we find as commonalities for all the kids that are the failing? Now we look at the Black students. What's different? What's the same? Right? Because maybe that community does have some special things, or special is not the right word, some unique characteristics that need to be addressed. Mm-hmm. But if there's if 7 out of the 10 characteristics aren't unique, mm-hmm. well, then now you've just said for everybody else, we're not going to give them the same thing that they need. We're only giving it to the Black students.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, that's something I didn't take into account, but yeah, that's a good point. I think for me, this hits home for me because, yeah, I was one of those Black kids who did poorly in school and didn't do well. And, you know, I wrote a blog. I used it as part of my blog post, Why Darnie Can't Read. on my blog post, High-End Theories. So the blog post is ties in to my struggles as a Black male in the school system. And so so that's why this is important to me. So I really want to see these guys do well. I want to see this program succeed. Mm-hmm. And it isn't just political allegiances that I'm tying to. I'm free now academically, and I'm free to get A's and get good grades because I've been empowered to do so by improving my lifestyle and reading more. So as far as the report goes, I think one of the things for the listener, this might be helpful for you guys, and just in general as a principal, when you guys are looking at any kind of literature and you want to assess it quickly, always look at the table of contents. Because the table of contents will tell you everything you need to know about the structure and the flow of thought for the document. So the way how this table of contents is outlined is, so it has the focus group results mainly. And so it looks at students' experiences in school, what students like about school, what students dislike about school, factors that help students engage or succeed in school, factors that prevent students from engaging or succeeding in school, and suggestions for supporting students in school. And I say all that to say, and you guys don't have to remember all that, but the common theme for all those main principles in this document is that school is the problem and school is the solution. And for that, I disagree. Mm-hmm. So I, off the bat, I'm not with that. My whole response and theory to that is that the problem that these kids are having doesn't start at school. It starts at home and ends at home. So they're asking the wrong questions. You know, what students like about school, what students dislike about school, suggestions for supporting students at school. No. What kind of learning environment have your parents cultivated for you? Mm-hmm. That's what we need to be looking at. So instead of asking the kids... Well,
I think you're kind of touching, and I don't want to take you off your tirade too much, because I think you're still going. You think okay. You got some good points to make. Mm-hmm. But I think, you know, I bring this up all the time, is like, I would agree, I think, where you're going is, like, I don't think this study did a good enough job of identifying causes.
Mm-hmm. You're right. Right.
So yes, we're identifying, like, the purpose of the study was orientated out of, you know, a couple different things, not just this, you know, they did a focus group on 87 kids that came from potentially unequal outcome statistics within Black community. You know, for example, Black kids or Black male students, I presume, mm-hmm. having a higher rate of failure within the school boards.
Or even like, you know, the complaints of being mistreated and hurting their ability to function well at school. Well,
yeah, so... But mm-hmm. So there's a combination effect, right? So I know that there's some preliminary studies. Mm-hmm. We'll share some YouTube clips. I think there's a really good one. There's like a 26-minute one on the YouTube page called Brampton Focus, where they go through it. And they kind of talked, like, you know, the genesis or the cause of this, you know, this study being, you know, trying to find the causes of why, you know, let's say there's an unequal outcome.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think they... not that this information isn't important, mm-hmm. but I think it's incomplete in that it doesn't take it to where you're going, which is, what are the causes, right? Yeah. So, you know, what are the other factors within these students' lives?
Mm-hmm.
And I think home life is a huge factor. I don't think it's the only factor.
Mm-hmm.
So I think all the things that you're going to say or are saying about home life are valid. But I would potentially push back on you and say, is there more? So, but yeah. Anyways, go continue on what you were saying, but I think it's just good framing.
Yeah, yeah. And we should get back to that. Yeah. So what I was just saying was that I've been on both sides of the fence, like I said before. I've been a very bad student, like, and now I'm a good student.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember what it was like being a bad student, being able, you know, walking into an exam, writing my name on the paper, then walking out.
Knowing you had no idea what was going on.
Bruh. I already failed. It was already over. It was over before it started.
You went to the exam because you had to go to the exam.
Yeah, I was just trying to be respectful.
Sort of.
Yeah, sort of. It was like, all right, here you go. You're going, oh, okay, wow. You know what I mean? So I'm saying that because, so in the report, it says out of the 87 people who were surveyed, so it said 48% of those people were engaged, successful students. Then it says 36% were disengaged, struggling students.
And then 16% were mixed, which basically, just for mixed. Clarification, means they used multiple factors to evaluate engaged versus successful. And so you might have had a student who was successful but disengaged, or unsuccessful but engaged, right? I'm assuming that's where the mixed category comes into play. But anyways,
yeah. Sorry. So my thing was this. Don't ask the kids who are disengaged and struggling what they want. That's wrong. Don't ask them that. Ask the kids who are engaged and successful, right? Ask them what they do to be successful, and then interview their parents to find out what their parents are doing to make their kids successful. Now, and just to preface my remarks, I'm not saying that discrimination doesn't happen at school. I'm not saying there are racist teachers at school. I'm not saying that teachers are, you know, don't mistreat students.
Or teachers aren't part of the problem some scenarios.
Yeah, yeah, I'm not discounting that. But even like if we throw those factors that are variables in there, there are 48% of those guys who are still engaged and doing well. So like why ask people who aren't doing well? Like because a lot of times we get into this political rhetoric of Black people are this, Black people are that. Black people are the Black students are feeling, well, hold on. No. There are Black kids who are doing well, and there are those who aren't doing well. So it's important to make that distinction, because once you make that distinction, you're like, okay, so those guys aren't doing well, but those guys are. Let's study those guys who are doing well and the homes they come from.
So so there's two things I want to. First would be, I totally agree with you with comparing the successful. I'll take it to another level. I think we should be looking at what are the other characteristics that, you know, and home life is part of it, you know, involvement with extracurricular activities, you know, just, I could come up with a couple different things, right? you know, whether it's sports and are they on sports teams? Are they in, you know, what do they do for summer camps, right? Do they, you know, or what do they have for summer programs, right? After school programs, you know, are they part of whatever it is, right? But the other thing I mentioned at the beginning, the idea of control group, right? When I see this composition of 48% successful, 36% disengaged, how does that compare to the rest of the student population? That's totally missing. I would say this, and this is where I thought control group was important, where they've taken previous studies of unequal outcome and kind of presumed those statistics are still true. Those results are going to be true within this population group, but they haven't verified it, right? Like, what if you're drawing conclusions about the 36% of those kids, but that 36% number is true for the white kids in the school? What if 30, like, then again, to go back to my point in the beginning, which was like, are we creating programs exclusively for black male students that can apply to all the students who are disengaged and struggling? And so now I would say that's reverse racism. Like, like, in that you're basically saying like, oh, black kids need this extra help that in actuality everybody else who's disengaged also needs. Mm-hmm. And essentially it's I would say it's racist in that you're giving the black kids special treatment when the other kids also need that treatment. Mm-hmm. Now, again, I'm only making that in the context of, because they lack the control group to validate, hey, if the ratio was 75-15 and 10, right, then now you have a legitimate argument to say, okay, yeah, the black students likely have additional factors that are contributing to their lack of success or their failures. And so now this is where your question of, like, looking at home life goes to the question of, what is the cause, right? So what is different about this 36% population than the 48% who are successful? Mm-hmm. And then also, what would be different, right? And then again, control groups, right? What is, like, what is different from the people who are successful?
Yeah.
Right? Are they not involved with sports? Yeah. Are they not involved with, you know, mentorship? Right. So if you're talking about, you know, like the example you're getting at, I presume, is an aspect of like single parents, right? Well, maybe the solution is adding greater access to Big Brother programs. But because the other factors of home life aren't really other factors of life aren't even considered. Mm-hmm. The other thing that I found kind of funny is, if you go down to the end of it, it goes like focus group results, and you read what students like about school and what students dislike about school, literally, it's the same thing. Meaning, like, some of them, it's the opposite, right? Mm-hmm. So some of them are like, oh, I felt included in sports, even though I was like the only black kid in the sports team or whatever. What they didn't like about school was, I was the only black kid on the sports team and I felt excluded. It's like, okay, there's a problem in your stats. Like, both can't be true if that's the actual underlying problem.
Interesting. I never thought about that.
Right? Like, yeah. So, you know, the other side was like friendships, and, you know, some of them, it's like saying, oh, I felt included. I felt like principals really didn't consider my race an issue. Then it turns around, the other person's like, I felt like race was an issue. What if these two kids are at the exact same school? You're essentially referring to the exact same teachers. Mm-hmm. And so, and I mean, the data doesn't tell us whether it's, because they did four schools in Brampton, four schools in Mississauga, one school in Caledon, total of 87 students. Mm-hmm. So you can look at the study. It tells you kind of the breakdown. But, you know, this is, again, goes back to that idea of control group, that, like, if you're getting the exact same, or if you're getting opposite answers, but in the exact same environment, that to me indicates a reporting bias. Meaning the person who's telling you the story, mm-hmm. it's about their personal experience as opposed to the actual environment that they're in. Mm. Because if two black kids, one is doing well in school, one's doing bad in school, mm-hmm. are describing their schools in polar opposite scenarios, mm-hmm. that to me goes, well, I don't know that I need to change the school. Like, what else is there? There has to be a differentiating factor. It's not the school. It's something else, mm-hmm. because they're in the exact same school. And so that's where, you know, I don't know. I just read, I'm like, wait a second. I just read the polar opposite of this of, mm-hmm. you know, and I, for example, preferential respect for school sports. It said, like, this is what students dislike about school. It's like, in some schools, there's a lack of respect and pride for basketball. I'm like, you know how many times I got to play floor hockey in school? Never. Like, never. I can honestly remember playing hockey, like, a handful of times. And, like, that was my sport.
Yeah.
So, and but at the same time, dude, like, what's the problem with basketball? If you can't, if you're not physically inclined, so.
But you know what, man? You know what, Joel? Like, again, like I said before, this is what kind of bakes my biscuits. Because, like I said, when I grew, I was a hooper. I was playing basketball 24/7. Mm-hmm. That's not the thing that's going to help you. Mm-hmm. Like so even that.
Getting a good mark in gym class has really,
yeah, at the end like, of the day. Like, yeah, oh, they don't take this stuff. No, this is not any. Anyways, yeah, but I'll get to that. I'll get to that later. yeah. Back to your question to me about why certain kids are doing better, certain black kids are doing better than other black kids. So what's interesting is that Statistics Canada, I was looking into this, doing my research for the Sixth Sense report.
No big deal.
I know, being
studious.
Yeah,
studious. Being a good
journalist.
Student.
Yo, economics for journalists, right? So I'm doing my research. I'm checking Statistics Canada, and they don't keep track of race stats, especially when it comes to school and these issues. So that's why they have to do their own survey, because there isn't one. We don't keep that, to keep those statistics. But maybe one of the factors that could play into who's doing well that I would like to know is what they should have kept track of is like ethnicity. Like, who are the ones killing it? Was it the Nigerians or was it the Jamaicans?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, because within the black community, if you see a disparity,
yeah,
that's potentially a problem for the narrative.
Right, yeah, because now you're like, oh, wow, like, oh, I didn't know, you know, Ghanaians are smarter than Nigerians.
No, or first-generation immigration, second-generation, yes, third-generation, yes, immigration. Yes. Like, yeah. Does that play a factor? If it does, right. Well, then, okay, well, what's the difference in those population groups?
Yeah, so that would have been good to see, and hopefully for the, you know, anybody that's associated with this report would, you know, listen to this. And you know, taking our perspective and try to find those stats, but I think, like, looking at this report, it, like I said, it kind of got me
frustrated,
and worried, because I don't think these are good solutions or the right way to look at the problem. When I was in school and when I was doing bad, I mostly had white teachers, and they were supportive.
Mm-hmm.
How supportive were they? They kept me in for remedial, right? So, you know.
Now, how did you look at that?
At the time?
At the time?
I'm like, oh, man. Oh, I was.
You didn't consider that. You did not consider that supportive, did you?
No. Actually, I thought, you know, they were, you know.
Harassing
me, were trying to ruin my life. Mr. Wilshire. You know, like grade five, I had reading comprehension and I didn't do well in my reading comprehension. So he made me stay back after school. And you know, I'm trying to figure that out. And when I was in high school.
So the reason why I asked you that question is because if someone did a survey on you,
yeah,
you would have given negative feedback.
Yeah.
Well, even though what was being done was actually positive.
Well, bro, and it's crazy because even, like, you know, years later, I'm in high school. And I'm like a star basketball player for my high school team. And so I didn't do my math homework one day. Well, I rarely ever did my math homework. Right? So my math teacher, and this was game day, right? So it was game day, home game, packed gym, rival game. My math teacher held me back. She told me that I'm not playing unless I finish my homework. So at tip off, I'm in math class, finishing homework that I didn't finish. Man, I was so offended. Like, I'm the man. Like I, you know,
you're gonna cost us the game.
Yeah, you know, I was just like, yo, bro. Like, I was just like, I can't believe she did that. Huh? Did we win? Yeah, we won. But again, like, so when I'm hearing these kids' stories about, you know, teachers tearing them down, I don't doubt that. But if your teacher's being rough on you because they want you to succeed, we have to make those distinctions.
But you know what's funny? On the flip side, in the report, it said in the section about factors that prevent students from engaging or succeeding in school, it said students concur that sometimes they create problems through their own actions. At times, they may have a bad attitude, dress poorly, or display inappropriate or disrespectful behaviors in school. Students also realize that they engage in behaviors that prevent them from succeeding in school. Example, get very little sleep at night, come to class unprepared, choose not to focus during class time. That sounds about right. If you're going to continue to act like that, you're not going to do well in school. And I remember behaving like that. So it's no coincidence that, you know, you act like that, you know, school is not going to go well for you.
Yeah, I think, you know, there's an episode of Tom Wood's show that just recently came out. It's called The Moral Mess of Higher Education, episode 1462. I'll have it in the show notes page. Mm-hmm. He interviews this guy, Phil Magnus, who co-wrote a book with Jason Brennan about the problems with higher education. And one of the chapters, or one part of this podcast, they were talking about the problem with evaluating teachers based on student evaluations. So there's value in student evaluations from the perspective of, like, oh, you're getting feedback from the people who are consuming the education from on the teacher. But the problem is kind of along the lines of what we've kind of went down already with respect to you while you were in grade five. You know, you're interpreting the feedback, or you're interpreting your experiences in a much different manner than you do as an adult who has a more independent or objective evaluation. And so the point is that, like, or what they make in this podcast is that, you know, students who do bad in a class are more likely to give the teacher a bad evaluation, even though they might have actually done a good job of teaching the content, right? Mm-hmm. So let's contrast this with an employer who's sending an employee to a certification class for training. If the student, or if the employee, comes back with the skills necessary, or fails and has to retake the course because they didn't acquire the skills, the employer is going to be happier with that than giving the person a pass who's not actually qualified. But the flip side is true, where with student evaluations, if the teacher is an easier marker, mm-hmm. you're more likely to get a higher evaluation. Mm-hmm. And therefore, the school would think they're a better teacher. Mm-hmm. But in reality, mm-hmm. they're a worse teacher, mm-hmm. because they're actually just making kids think they're smarter than they are, mm-hmm. or making them think they comprehend the material better than they do. Mm-hmm. Like, I remember I was TAing a management accounting course. And I marked the test the first time. The class average was like 35. And the prof made me redo the marks. I was literally handing out like one mark for writing a sentence. I was like, there's not like nothing on the answer to this question. Mm-hmm. And like, I just had to get the class average up to like 65. Mm-hmm. But it basically was a reflection of the fact the teacher was probably really, really poor. Mm-hmm. I had him as a teacher. He was horrible. I essentially was giving out like marks, like two or three marks on a five mark questions for like incomprehensible answers, but they wrote something. And to me, this is an example where, like, oh, the people are going to give a good mark to the teacher because even though they deserved a 40, they were getting 65.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, it's, yeah, that's definitely an issue where you look at, you know, kids doing the evaluation. And that's why
self-reporting bias.
Yes, self-reporting, right? Bias. And that's why I wanted to see like parents, and like I said, like all this, like, education starts in the home and ends with the home. So I would have liked to see a survey done with the parents whose kids who did well. So like, for example, in my blog post, Black Love, White Lies, I talked about the three principles
that exist within every community that define every ethnicity. So in light of what we saw in the report with those who did well and those who didn't do well, the achievers and the non-achievers, looking at the homes that they come from. So in the blog post, Black Love, White Lies, I talk about the achiever, non-achiever principle. Achiever, non-achiever, and deviant principle. So the achiever values work as a means of getting ahead, delayed gratification, for the sake of a better future. And then the non-achiever, who devalues work as a means of getting ahead, instant gratification with disregard for the future. And then the third group is the deviant, those who reject laws and institutions. They believe all existence is meaningless. And I say all that to say that every ethnicity has these groups within them. Every ethnicity group has these particular groups within their community. And so the majority of every group has achievers. Well, how do I know this? Well, look at the stats. Look at the stats from the report, right? Mm-hmm. The majority 50%. Of those. Yeah, 50%. That's a big number in light of the narrative within the Black community. Mm-hmm. Because when you watch the YouTube channel or the YouTube post that we'll post on the report, it'll be a blanket statement. Blacks feel discouraged.
Yes. No. It did not reflect the 50% number at all.
It didn't. Right. So when you hear people talk, it won't reflect those who are doing well. And again, like I said, that's a common narrative where Black people are talked about as non-achievers. But the stats, based on what the report said, that we do have majority are achievers.
And if you ever heard the term soft bigotry of low expectations.
Well, I've never heard that before.
Does that make sense to you, though? Soft bigotry of low expectations.
Yeah.
That's essentially what that is, right? Yeah. Because I would say the problem then is if they're rolling this program out, mm-hmm. or the goal is to roll it out universally to Black students, mm-hmm. you potentially now make the 50% who are engaged and successful mm-hmm. have come in with a preconceived notion mm-hmm. that's false.
Yeah, right. See?
And that's my point. And then that's the whole self-fulfilling prophecy idea where like, oh, you're going to fail unless you do these things, you have to work.
Right. So that's what I'm saying. Like, if they interviewed the people that made these kids, the parents, and the environments that they created, and really looked at the difference between the kids who aren't doing well, their parents, and the kids who are doing well, and those parents. And then what you're going to see is that you're going to see achiever values. You're going to see a value for hard work, delayed gratification. And then with the non-achiever, you're going to see those who devalue work as a means of getting ahead and instant gratification. And so that's why it's important to make sure that we're nuancing the conversation and not just making the blanket statement. So in my blog post, Why Darnie Can't Read, there are two principles that I propose that influence the home scholastically. Okay. So the principle is word-based cultures, image cultures.
Okay.
Word-based cultures, image cultures. Word-based cultures in your home are ones that value words, books. Image.
Learning.
So image-based cultures are ones that value television, looking good.
Mm-hmm. Perceptions.
Perceptions. And this is me giving the audience what turned it around for me, was that I grew up in an image-centered home, right? So mm-hmm. TV was very big. Mm-hmm. Materialism was very big. And I'm not throwing my mom and dad under the bus. They were young parents, and they did the best they could with what they knew. They gave me a great childhood, and that's why I'm a happy person today. But we didn't have a word culture. We didn't read books. We didn't have a library. We didn't mm-hmm. read. That wasn't a thing. So it hurt me. It hurt me because all I did was watch TV. you know what I mean? So that's why I was struggling in school, and it wasn't the teacher's fault.
So, I mean, the interesting thing for me, like, I have two brothers. Mm. If you look at us in high school, I'm engaged and successful. My middle brother, disengaged, struggling. My little brother, pretty much mixed. So of the three categories of composition, you have three people with the exact same home life falling into all three categories. Now, obviously, there's...
But the assumption is there would be equal outcome.
And in essence...
Between the three of you.
It's completely different. And the biggest thing might have just come down to, like, you know, I think one of the things that contributed to my success or my engagement in school was literally my grade five teacher. And I was only at this school for 1 year before, because I went to John Knox Christian School up till grade four. My dad got in a car accident, couldn't work. He didn't get a good settlement, whatever. He couldn't work for like 2 years. So we had like, basically couldn't go to a Christian school anymore. Went to a public school. And then we moved. So really we were only at this school for 1 year. But I had a teacher who would send us home with like a full scap of paper with homework questions. But every two questions was a different subject. And so I felt like, I always remember kind of enjoying that homework assignment, because by the time I was like, oh, that was so hard, I don't like it anymore, I'm doing a different subject, or I'm doing something different that, like, you know, kept me engaged, kept me wanting to do the homework. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'd say maybe that was a contributing factor. I don't know. But I also know, like, you know, I would say my brothers are pretty smart. I did really well in school. I did extremely well in university. I was, you know, when I look at my parents, you know, my father especially, like, didn't really value education. Without going down the rabbit hole, but what I mean by that is, like, he didn't look at the school system with a high regard. Mm. But I still, you know, I was the first kid in my family, or first person in my family to go to university. Mm. You know, but I came from a culture where, in terms of my family culture, you know, hockey took precedence, right, over school. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, I was the worst hockey player of the three of us, so it made it easy to prioritize school. But my point is that, you know, there's so many factors in, you know, if you look at me versus my brothers, you know, what might have been a negative factor for me impacted them way more. Mm-hmm. And so what other factors? Maybe it was the fact that one was the middle brother. And so, you know, that's an aspect where, like, I go back to, what is the cause, right? What are the commonalities of these students that are failing? Maybe it's all bunch of them are all little brothers and middle brothers. Mm-hmm. Like, which sounds, you know, you might think like, oh, that's absurd. Well, I don't know. The data isn't giving me the enough amount of characteristics and statistics to really identify cause, mm-hmm. right? Like, this is where... You know, a statistician, when you're doing stats and you're trying to find cause, you need to control for variables. And I would say, you know, you bring up a huge one, which is home life, right? So not to throw anyone under the bus, but this idea of like single parentness, you just have less time. You know, two parents have more ability to, mm-hmm. to, you know, divide and conquer and right. designate time to be like, okay, you need to do your homework. You need to instill, like, whereas the single parent might be having to work two jobs.
Yes.
And you're coming home.
Yes.
Doing your homework with no accountability.
Yeah.
Right. And so, you know, what is the school environment going to do potentially? Hey, big brother programs or things like that, where, like, if they've identified that, you know, the students that are failing have a single parent scenarios as more common. Okay, what can we, you know, whatever, all these recommendations aren't going to address that as a huge causation, if that's the causation. And the point is, for me, and I think you raised the question well, is like, by not really comparing the two students other than their opinion of school, you're not really getting into causation enough. I don't think this study is bad in and of itself. I just think it's incomplete. I think it needs much deeper analysis. Mm-hmm. I also think potentially only 87 students is a really small sample size. And especially if you had 87 students that were
black, what would be a good male, sample size?
It's not that 87 in and of itself is bad. It's that 87 black male students. Well, why not have, you know, 500 students where 150 of them are black, 80, 90 of them are black male, 60 of them are black female. Like, why not include black females, right? Just as, again, contrast. What's the difference? Well, part of the thing is, you know, in general, we know that the school system, I'll say we know, but if you look it up, in general, the structure of a school system is better designed for the way females operate, mm-hmm. right? Why do we have so many males in school diagnosed with ADD? because sitting still for that long doesn't work great with males.
Bro, real quick, I don't even want to, you know, get off topic, but so the company I work for, I joined I was part of the program called coding with kids.
Okay.
And so we would go to the elementary school and teach kids coding. Programming. Through Minecraft.
Yeah.
Right. So
playing games.
But long story short, I went to the school and I haven't been to an elementary school in like
a long time.
Since I was in elementary school, right?
A long time.
And I went there and I was hanging around, I was in the environment, I was in the staff room, sitting around with the teachers. And the aura I got, or the feeling I got, it was very mommy-ish. It just had this aura of mommy. Yeah, you know, because there's, you know, it's a lot of women, and just it was just like, oh, okay, grade twos, okay, grade threes, okay, John, and I was just like, oh man, like I'm not hearing any, you know, baritone, I'm not hearing any bass, yeah. You know, I'm not hearing the presence of men, and I say that to say, like you said, like the school system is
tailored
to women, and it has a feminine feel to the school system. And I say that to tie back into the report. If the issue's with males, then shouldn't there be a particular male solution? If the problem is a male problem, then it should be
black males. But it's males.
But it should be. But there should be like a particular masculine male solution to the problem. And dare I say, what turned it around for me was not just a family, but a male-led family that turned it around for me academically.
Well, in essence, you needed male mentorship.
Yes. So I got that. So like I said, I grew up in an image-centered home. Mm-hmm. And then my mom and dad separated when I was 9 years old. So it was just, you know, my single-parent mom with me and my sister. And that's what it was, image-centered, or came home, watched TV. I was a latchkey kid. Latchkey kid is a person who comes home and their parents aren't home, so they have a key.
Oh, latchkey.
Yeah, it's a latchkey kid. So, you know, you come home and, you know, you're watching Transformers, G.I. Joe, Thundercats,
whatever you want,
cereal, toast, until mom comes home in the evening, makes dinner, and you go to bed. That was it. Yeah. But anyways, but what turned around for me was that I was brought into a word-centered home when I was attending Family Life under Pastor David Safri. And he brought me into his home. And
how old were you?
I was in my early 20s, okay. But it was a paradigm shift because I've never heard men. When he said, I remember he said, my greatest joy is to read my Bible. I thought I was in a cult. I've never heard a man talk like that in my whole life, Joel. Mm-hmm. Like the men I know don't talk like that. So automatically he had my attention. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay, keep talking. This is not what I see on TV or what I've been hearing in my music. Nobody has ever said that.
Yeah.
He didn't say, oh, I love Jesus. He said, I love reading the Bible. I'm like, you love reading? What man does that?
Yeah.
So
what's reading?
Right. So he brought me into his home. He introduced me to his library. And he was just pointing at the books. He'd be like, oh, this one's about this. Oh, this one's about this. So now my mind is opening up. And I'm like, wait a minute, there's books on this? I'm like, how do you know what's what? How do you know what's true? And he's having those conversations with me. And he started a book club at the church. And so for the men. So, you know, we're all reading, you know, the same book. And I'm seeing guys reading. And now that's what changed everything for me. Well, I'm like, okay, so this is manly. This is what men do. This is cool. And it was cool. I know it sounds dorky, but it was cool. Even going to the Legacy Conference and seeing guys that rappers and guys that look like me who rap, but they're teaching courses and walking through books and suggesting books, walking through Shylin, walking through systematic theology. When I went to go the Legacy and I'm sitting in the class with Shylin and he's walking through systematic theology, the big blue book, it made reading look cool. It made being a scholar look cool. It looked manly to be able, like the Bible says, the Bible encourages men to read to their wives, read to your kids, read to your community.
Wash
that's
your
manly.
Wife in the word.
Yeah, wash your wife in the word. Ephesians 5, that's manly. So now my disposition is like, yo, like reading is manly. That's what men do. It's cool. Mm-hmm. That's what cool people do. As opposed to, you know, reading isn't cool. So that was the male solution for me to see men reading, but also having that family environment, bringing somebody into their home and having the men at the church. There was a gentleman named Brother Sal. And so he's like the OG at the church. So every time I had a question about Islam and the Bible and the origin of the Bible, you know, he would sit down with me and talk to me and walk me through the Bible and finding these solutions. And then you had like Brother Arthur. Now, he didn't know much about, he didn't tell me much about the scriptures, but he told me how to change a tire, how to an oil change, how to fix your car, you know, how to put up drywall.
Yeah.
But these guys held me accountable and busted my butt and showed me like, yo, as a man, you got to get your stuff. You got to get your ish together. Get your ish together so you could be productive. So there was a call on me by other men to do well. And I'm saying that these men, and I'm proposing, I don't know what those successful parents said, but I'm sure there's still some kind of male mentor influence.
Well, and this is where I think, you know, in general, the single parent scenario, you know, for single parents out there, recognizing that there's always like the dilemma is that your child doesn't have more than one voice, and you as an individual are biased, right? Like, you know, I think of me and my wife with my kid, right? Like, she's in general, this is a male versus female, I don't want to say stereotype, but let's call it norms. Where, like, she's overly worried about his, you know, safety, and I'm under worried about his safety, right? I'm more willing to let him fall down the stairs, and she's more, like, making sure he doesn't even slip.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
but, yeah. But like, you know, part of me, like, it's like I said, you know, obviously I'm within reason. I'm not going to let him fall from the top of the stairs.
Yeah,
but it's
like
when he's at the bottom two or three steps, it's like he needs to learn. If you're not careful, things happen.
Yeah.
And so, you know, there's that, you know, those contrasts of approach that to some extent I would say, you know, it's a product of our government mandated school system where, you know, it's become a culture of a particular nature.
And, a feminine one.
Well, yeah, but also just not even necessarily more feminine, but more tailoring to the approach females learn in.
Mm-hmm.
So whether it's feminine or not is not really like, maybe you're right, maybe you're not, but it's like, you know, men, unfortunately, for those of you who disagree, men and women are different. And as a result, like, you know, boys generally are more rowdy. Yeah, there's women that break the norm. There's men that break the norm. But like, you know, men, maybe the boys need to be out in recess double the amount of time that females need recess.
Right.
Yeah. Right. And as a result, you're now going to have a more productive male student because he had twice as much time to run around.
Right. Or even like the content in the literature. So again, like part of my turnaround, of course, was the Bible. But what was fascinating about the Bible was that God didn't play. Like, you know, I've watched Juice. I've watched Tupac kill his friends.
Yeah.
I watched Menace to Society. I seen Boys in the Hood and guys get shot up because they don't play. Mm-hmm. But God is on a whole nother level of I don't play, which was very captivating to me. It was gangster.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you think Bishop and Juice was gangster. Yo, God is gangster. God does not play. And as a man, that was very manly. That was to me. That was just very like, I'm like, oh shoot, like God ain't playing. Jesus ain't playing. Like next time he coming, you know, the Jesus we saw getting beat up isn't the Jesus that's coming back.
Mm-hmm.
Right? He's coming. You know, he's coming back to shed some blood. So at that point, I mean, tell me more. Like, now I'm reading. Now you got my attention.
Mm-hmm.
Now I want to read more about this God that's going to come back and slaughter some people. Mm-hmm. Right? It's kind of like the episode of The Simpsons. I don't remember the episode of The Simpsons. Bart Simpson is bored to death in Sunday school class. And as soon as Reverend Lovejoy opens up, you know, he gets onto the lesson about the devil. You know, Bart's like, oh boy, all right, the good stuff. He's like, finally, now we're at the good stuff. Well, why does he say we're finally at the good stuff? Yeah, because that's intriguing to a young male
battle.
Mind. Yeah, because you're like, oh great, the devil. Okay, now what does he do? How does he hurt people? How does he kill people? Like, tell me.
Yeah, why do we like playing cops and robbers? I mean, even now, like Nerf guns, like, you know, with my nephews, like, you
those
know,
are the best.
Shooting pop cans or whatever, right? Just like, you know, that, like, I don't know what it is, but it's just fun.
So for these guys who are doing well, I'm sure that their family situation is different, and I was just proposing that potentially that the male problem, the male problem that we're seeing with black males not doing well probably needs a male solution as opposed to fem. So when people are proposing solutions, I'm like, okay, does this apply to women too? Because they, again, we want to find solutions. I want to see all these guys do well. All these black males do well, and white males. I want to see males do well in general.
I mean, I want to see people do well.
People, yeah, of course. And yeah, you want to see women do well.
Females need men to do well.
Yeah.
Men need females that do well.
Yeah. Ask the ladies. Well, how do women feel about men that enjoy reading and that read to them and that can hold an intellectual conversation? Ask the ladies what they think.
Yeah. Versus the male who's not responsible.
And doesn't, and is not, and is, has no goals, and
the one who doesn't care about the education,
and doesn't read,
isn't able to educate your kids,
right?
Yeah, that sounds like a great husband.
right. So again, I think it's important that we look at this report and say, okay, look, man, we're not trying to tear it down, but how can it be better to find solutions? So, like, okay, my two cents is, in my opinion, there are major limitations to be addressed
with the solution.
Right, yeah, because I really believe that the kids who aren't doing well, their parents, though they want well, they want their kids to do well, they don't know how to make their kids successful. And I'm speaking about myself again. Yeah. Like, my mom and dad wanted me to be successful, but they didn't know how to create an environment for that to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And that's no shot against them. They just don't know. Some parents just don't know how to make their kids do well in school. Though they want them to do well, and I think that's a distinction that we need to tackle and wrestle with. And I also think, lastly, that it's unfair. It's an unfair burden we put on teachers for them to take the brunt of the blame for kids not doing well.
Mm-hmm.
I think that burden is way too heavy, because I'm studying, and I'm planning to be a teacher one day, and apply maybe one day for the Peel District School Board. So now hopefully this episode doesn't come back to haunt me where they're like, oh wait,
oh, you bashed us,
all right, well,
just pick a different school board.
Yeah, okay. Pick right. But again, so I as a future teacher, I want to see students do well, because I remember what it was like not to do well.
Well, see, and I would say the one problem, I think my perception, maybe I'm wrong, is that much of the school boards and similar want them to be the only aspect of education. They don't want families to be a part of the responsibility, because that, there's a component of like, oh, we got this, it's our responsibility. And so rather than they're like, if you look at the solutions, it's all about more money within the school. It's like curriculum based. It's accountability. Yeah, there's not, the first one is engage with the community. But it's educators and families. Like, as a, it comes, so much of it's coming back to the school, as opposed to, the family. And to, again, my two cents goes like, your data to me doesn't really find cause. It helps identify the people that you want to use to figure out the cause, but it doesn't actually get to the causal level. And I bring this up all the time when we talk about government programs. Why? Because it's all about symptom management. Oh, there's a problem in society. Here's the symptom. Let's show that we're good at it by throwing money at the problem, as opposed to doing the due diligence to get to the level of going, what is the cause? Because unfortunately, a lot of times the cause has so much level of nuance that a government program can't actually resolve it. So, for the listener, give us your feedback. Where are we maybe blind? What did, maybe we missed something in this report that's...
Maybe we were too heavy-handed.
But as I said, I think we find the report as a good starting point. We're not dismissive of the report as a whole, mm-hmm. but we think it needs a deeper dive into the individuals. I would say it needs a greater amount of participants. If it's really going to draw conclusions, you need a better control group. You need black females. You need white females. You need all students.
Yeah.
Is it demonstrating male versus female? Actually doing a comprehensive study and showing, what are the factors for particular groups? Whether it's, let's just call it minority groups. Maybe other minority groups have different, very distinctly different problems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And again, our tagline is the sixth sense. Sixth sense makes change. And if you want to see change, of course, listen and put these principles in action, but also share the show.
Comment on your podcast catcher, you know, comment on social media, comment, yeah. Share, you know,
give us a rating. Give us a rating.
Good old Facebook algorithm appreciates it too.
Yeah. And again, like, yes, you know, yes, you're listening, but again, like, part of the change is sharing the ideas and not just keeping it to yourself. If you know somebody who might find it, who would enjoy this or find this challenging to their worldview, like, share it. Like, yeah, you talk about you don't see change. Well, part of it is, as our, you know, part of our, you know, the Sixth Sense Support family, like, share the content to other people is part of Sixth Sense in Exchange. So please, yeah, give us our feedback, and yeah, thank you guys for your support thus far.
But you heard me? Does that make sense? I hear.